Good afternoon, everyone, and I can't thank you enough for being here, the media. Thank you for all of the people that have traveled here today for this very important issue. Before I start, I just want to acknowledge some of the people that are in attendance that are not going to be speaking. I'll announce the speakers later. But we have Deandra Williams. She's the executive, director of the Hudson Valley House of Hope that takes care of domestic violence victims. Kelly Morris. Kelly's sitting down. Sorry, Kelly, thank you for being here. She's the Universal Response to Domestic Violence Project Coordinator. Christopher Quick, President of the New York State Police Investigators Association. Richard Wells, President of the Police Conference of New York State. Richard, thank you. East Fishkill Police Chief Matt Orsino. Matt, thank you for being here as well. The Executive Director of the State Sheriff's Association, Peter Kehoe. Thank you, Peter. Rensselaer County DA, Mary Pat Donnelly. Thank you, Mary. And Dutchess County Sheriff's Officers, Carmine Romeo and Jean Aiken. Thank you very much for being here today. In less than 2 months, sweeping criminal justice reform will go into effect. And you guys know me, I'm not one to really hold press conferences, but this subject and this bill is just too important not to. One of the biggest reforms that we're about to see is cashless bail, an initiative that means only 90% of criminals will walk free, nearly 90% of criminals will walk free instead of being held until trial. On January 1st, 2020, if a person commits manslaughter in the second degree, that person will not be held or qualify for bail. In less than 2 months, if a person commits criminally negligent homicide, that person will not be held or qualified for bail. When this law takes effect, if a person commits aggravated assault on a child, that person will not be held or qualified for bail. Albany's new leaders claimed cashless bail would create a fairer system. But in their rush to reform, they fail to consider the very real danger that these sweeping changes will have on communities as a result of the failure to grant judges the ability to even consider the safety risks a person poses to others. That's not justice. As lawmakers, public safety must always be our top priority, and we have a duty to ensure that the voices of victims are heard, not ignored as they have been throughout this process. Today, along with my colleagues, Senator Pat Gallivan, I'm introducing two pieces of legislation to build on our victims' justice agenda, and I'm proud to be doing so surrounded by those that are on the front line. Members of law enforcement, the District Attorneys Association of New York, and victims' advocates. These are the people who fight every single day to keep our communities safe and to empower victims. These are the people whose concerns we need to take seriously and whose voices should inspire immediate action. The first measure we're introducing today will give judges discretion over dangerous defendants instead of only allowing them to assess whether a person is a flight risk. Our legislation would permit judges to actually consider dangerousness when determining whether an individual should be held pretrial. And you know, you think about our judges, a lot of these, you know, have repeat offenders. They know the histories. They are the best ones to make this judgment call. This tool is especially important in domestic violence cases and cases where a defendant has shown a propensity for violence. Of extreme concern are victims of domestic violence who are at a higher risk of re-victimization. You know, domestic violence victims have enough of a hard time just coming forward. They're fearful of their abusers. And now to find out that they're not even going to be detained, they're going to get an appearance test ticket, and possibly an order of protection. We all know that order of protection is good as this piece of paper that I'm holding before you. The second bill we're introducing would ensure that each crime under the aggravated family offense statute, domestic violence and sex crimes, would qualify for bail and pretrial detention. These vulnerable victims, as we have learned through hearings that took place only after this measure became law, are not guaranteed orders of protection. The most we've heard is that a judge would probably issue one. Probably is just not good enough. We can and we must do better to ensure that reform does not mean injustice for vulnerable victims. Today, we were calling on our colleagues to do the right thing and make the changes that are necessary to truly protect victims. With that, I'd like to turn it over to former state trooper, former Erie County Sheriff, and ranker on the Senate Codes Committee, my friend Pat Gallivan.
Thank you, Senator Cirino, and everybody standing with us today, or we're standing with you, and we thank you for the work that you do to help keep our community safe, to help protect victims, and the work, of course, that you will do, and we acknowledge your concerns. It's been troubling to me over the past year where we've seen criminal justice legislation that has continued to favor offenders over victims. And as we move forward, the particular legislation dealing with bail, the cashless bail in particular, is a perfect example of that. And not just troubling mentally, but troubling and concerning going forward when you look at our communities. So we've got a piece of legislation that, again, is looking at offenders. No consideration for what a repeat offender might do once they get an appearance ticket and go back out there. So that person, that individual who is strung out on drugs or is an addict that is arrested for breaking into somebody's house, they're returned to go back out there and break into another house. The repeat drunk driver is free to go back out and drive drunk again. The repeat burglar, the repeat a person who is inclined to violence, but not quite violence with a gun or a knife, that might want revenge on people, they will continue to go out there. 50% of people across the country recidivate. So just extrapolate those numbers out, and somebody released on bail who, and at least 50% of them are most likely to already be repeat offenders, are going to go back out there. 47 states, if I'm correct, meaning only three states do not do this. 47 states permit judges to consider public safety in their determination as to whether or not to set bail. New York should be one of them. It's interesting to me, with this particular piece of legislation, among others, that law enforcers, prosecutors, victims advocates, and others remain concerned with, just the sole piece of legislation dealing with bail, that you've got all these individuals speaking out, and then you look at the elected officials across communities, across the state, at every level, at the state level, at the county level, at the city level, at the town village level, speaking out. None other than Mayor de Blasio, who stated, and I quote, "Judges should be able to consider the dangerousness of defendants. We have to protect the public. I concur." Many Democrats across the state concur. Many Republicans across the state concur. But more importantly, the professionals that are charged with protecting our communities and protecting our victims concur. Changes to the criminal justice system were and are warranted. But they need to be done smartly. You need to be looking at evidence. You need to consult with professionals. You obviously need to keep up with the times, and that's our job as lawmakers, to continually look at the laws and make adjustments as necessary. But when we go from zero to 100, we are completely leaving out victims, we're completely leaving out our communities, and I get asked, not just in my district, time and again, I get asked across the state from people, who is looking out for us? Who's looking out for our victims? Who's looking out for our families? Who's looking out for our communities? We are. And we implore our colleagues on the majority side to do the same and make the necessary adjustments to keep our community safe. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Gallivan. Oops. Sorry. Okay, and now I'd like to introduce Leah Feldman. She is the Vice President for Community Programs at Family Services of Poughkeepsie.
Good afternoon. My name is Leah Feldman, and I'm the Vice President for Community Programs at Family Services. We provide 24-hour services to victims of domestic violence, sexual assault, and other crimes. And a large part of our work is partnering with the criminal justice system to ensure a trauma-informed and victim-centered response, prioritizing victim safety as well as public safety. Domestic violence is a pattern of power and control, which escalates over time. Unfortunately, all too often, we see patterns of escalation which, if not interrupted, result in serious injury and death. The risk is not just to victims, but to their children, to responding police officers, to family members, pets, and entire communities. Leading research indicates that for every intimate partner homicide, there is an average of 9 non-lethal assaults. This allows an opportunity for the system to intervene and interrupt the cycle of escalating violence. In particular, the pretrial phase, the time between an offender's arrest and sentencing, is known to be the most dangerous time for a victim of domestic violence. This is a time that a victim is most likely to be killed. If the criminal justice system prioritizes safety, this is also the time where a victim can connect with service providers, increasing their likelihood of finding independence and safety. The criminal justice system can support this by enforcing conditions that will monitor offenders post-arraignment, setting bail, incarceration, protective actions for the victim and the community. Bail reform strictly regulates what pretrial conditions a judge can set for domestic violence offenses, including elimination of bail for most domestic violence misdemeanor cases. These are the cases where intervention is most critical. Issuing an appearance ticket or releasing offender will systematically embolden offenders to keep committing acts of violence, as well as disempower victims from seeking safety through the criminal justice system. It is critical that New York State consider additional options. Research shows that in the year prior to homicide, more than 44% of abusers are arrested, and almost one-third of victims contact the police. These contacts demonstrate missed opportunities to prevent homicide. Domestic violence is a unique crime requiring a unique response. Research demonstrates that homicide is predictable and thus it's preventable, but sweeping changes to the criminal justice system without consideration of the unique risks that a domestic violence offender poses to their partner, to their children, and to the community will result in increased danger and heightened risk of homicide. In 2017, 108 victims of domestic violence were killed in New York State. Please remember victims of domestic violence, those that have survived, those that have not, and those that are still fighting. Thank you to Senators Serino and Gallivan for leading the way here, blazing the trail for us, and thank you for others in your consideration of this life-saving legislation.
Okay, and the next person that I would like to introduce is Bronca Bryan. She is the executive director of the Grace Smith House that also takes care of our domestic violence victims.
Thank you. I think Leah said it incredibly well. Thank you. I am here as a domestic violence provider. I work with victims every single day. My concern is that this bail reform is going to put victims at risk, more risk from their abusive partners, who victims have just been victimized, and they will see their partner right back at home in many cases. Domestic violence is a repetitive crime. It is a progressive crime. It gets worse over time. And we typically see victims in our agency right after an incident has happened. That's the time that is critical for us to work with someone to get to safety. Victim safety needs to be considered in every offense that is perpetrated against them, not just the most violent of those offenses. The inability to consider bail leaves the victim at risk from immediate reoffense. Safety of victims is what our community system is designed for. And we appreciate what Senator Gallivan and Sue Serino are doing for us. Thank you.
Thank you, Bronca. Thank you. Okay, and next we are going to hear from the Orange County District Attorney and current president of the District Attorneys Association of the State of New York, David Hoover.
Thank you, Senators. On behalf of the District Attorneys of the State of New York, we fully support these two amendments as being reasonable and as being necessary. All the district attorneys across the state supported some type of change in one form or another to both our bail and discovery laws. I think what the District Attorneys Association's main problem with it was how it was done. Input was not sought from us. It was done very quietly. It was done very quickly. It was done in the budget process. Public hearings were not held until after the law was put into place. When you just look at the law as it exists now, you can see that certain things were overlooked. I cannot imagine that the legislature actually thought that manslaughter should not be included, as well as some of the other 400 crimes that are not. But imagine this as we move forward in the new year. And it's been mentioned, house burglars, serial drunk drivers, repeat drug offenders will all be given a ticket and will all be released. What are the police in our communities going to say to the people that live there when someone calls up and reports that there's drug dealing on my corner, and they see the police officer show up, and they see the police officer arrest the individual for selling drugs, and 3 hours later, the individual is back? I cannot imagine that the individuals that passed this thought through these very scenarios, or thought through how those scenarios are going to affect public safety. They are going to affect public safety, and they will affect public safety very, very soon after January 1st. Eventually, they will have a chilling effect on people coming forward and wanting to cooperate with law enforcement and being part of the process. So, again, every district attorney in this state wanted some type of reform and wanted it done in a meaningful manner. What we got, I believe, is a hodgepodge of things that were not well thought out. And when you actually think about the fact that there's over 400 crimes that are completely ineligible for bail, completely ineligible, it makes you wonder, did anybody put forth the time and the effort to actually look at all of these? Domestic violence, one of the bills being presented here today, increases that. I cannot imagine what it will like being a domestic violence victim in the future, knowing that the person that abused you can be right back out within a short period of time. Orders of protection, pieces of paper that are issued by the court that basically say someone has to stay away from you or they should refrain from harassing you. Yes, they have the force and effect of the court and of law enforcement, but we know very well that that doesn't stop people from continuing to do that. And as Leah said, she said it very well. So on that note, I'll end with the District Attorneys Association and our members support these two amendments as being very reasonable and as being very necessary. And I want to point out just how subtle the differences is. The bill that is being presented by the senator here, it allows judges to consider dangerousness in a case. Why do we have judges? Why do we elect judges? Why do we appoint judges? Why do we have a judicial branch of government if we are going to completely make them powerless in cases that affect our public safety? Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Sunny.
Thank you. Okay, and the next speaker will be Matt Weishaupt. He's the Assistant District Attorney from Dutchess County.
Good afternoon, everyone. As Senator Serino told you, my name is Matt Weishaupt. I'm the Chief Assistant in Dutchess County, and I appear here today on behalf of our District Attorney, William Grady. I want to thank District Attorney Hoover for all the work he has done as the President of the District Attorneys Association for this state. Laws are about striking a balance. The laws that have been created here with no input from the other side create no balance. They've left out the victim. There is no balance for the victim. This legislation that is being proposed today by Senator Serino and Gallivan attempt to strike that balance on behalf of the victim. And as you heard Leah Feldman say, nowhere is that more important than in the area of domestic violence. Domestic violence is at a heightened premium to occur immediately after arrest. If the courts and the judges don't have the discretion to set bail where appropriate, whether after hearing or not, we have reformed nothing. We have broken the system. We have dismantled it. And we have favored those who commit crimes over those who try to live their life in a law-abiding way every day and have become victims not by choice, but by being struck out at by a defendant. There need be balance. This legislation simply proposes to balance that part which has been left out, that for the victim. I stand here today on behalf of District Attorney Grady, and I extend my sincere thanks to both Senator Gallivan and Senator Serino for attempting to balance this equation and to keep victims safe where necessary. DA Hoover gave you some examples where this is going to happen and people are going to be right back on the street. The DA's Association wanted to compromise, wanted to reform, wanted to help, but they were kept out of the conversation. I would suggest to you that it's not the right way to legislate and create laws, and I would suggest that these proposals tend to strike a balance that will be helpful. Thank you very much.
Okay, and now we are going to hear from the Delaware County Sheriff, Craig DeMond, who is here today on behalf of the New York State Sheriff's Association.
Thank you, Senators. We really appreciate the invite here today. Good afternoon. My name is Sheriff Craig DeMond. I'm the Sheriff of Delaware County, New York, an officer and member of the Legislative Committee within the New York State Sheriff's Association. On behalf of my fellow sheriffs across New York, our association president, Oneida County Sheriff Rob Machel, and our executive director, Peter Kehoe, it is my privilege to deliver some remarks today regarding this dangerous issue. And it is a dangerous issue. Let me begin by saying the fact that these bills are even necessary should make it very clear just what's in store for the law-abiding citizens of the state of New York come January 1st. Very few crimes that are currently there will be eligible for bail. And in these cases, bail can only be applied if a judge determines there is a risk of flight based on a very limited, reduced set of criteria. These so-called reforms will only apply to supposedly nonviolent offenses. But just because a crime is technically nonviolent under the law doesn't mean that it isn't incredibly serious or involve physical aggression. It doesn't mean that these crimes don't come with appropriately stiff sentences that would make a defendant think twice about submitting to the justice system. Crimes like vehicular manslaughter, as we've heard about, and felony animal abuse, or selling drugs to children. What's more, some violent crimes are specifically exempted from being eligible for bail. And this is a narrative that's not out there. Crimes like robbery in the second degree and burglary, home burglary in the second degree. I believe that if New Yorkers truly understood what is going to happen on January 1st, they would be shocked and horrified. I'll be the first to say that we can always improve our criminal justice system here in New York, and the sheriffs of New York State believe that there's always improvements that can be made. However, the fact that the criminal justice professionals that are gathered here today were not even given the consideration when these laws were crafted and passed is very disheartening. Right now, we are one of the safest large states in the country, I think that without drastic changes to this upcoming law, like the common sense bills proposed today, public safety in New York will deteriorate as a result. These measures we're discussing here today are the least we can do. Protecting the victims of domestic violence should be one of our highest priorities. Expanding the listing of qualifying crimes for bail to include all domestic violence crimes and allowing judges to consider the dangerousness in making bail determinations will certainly help accomplish that. However, even if these changes do take place, there remain a host of serious crimes that will remain non-qualifying offenses. Drug felonies being the most serious of this category. Our governor claims to be a champion in combating the opioid epidemic. However, he and many like him in the state legislature supported these so-called reforms, which will result in the immediate release of fentanyl-level drug dealers right back into our communities. How can this possibly have a positive effect on the community and the opioid epidemic? Come on. Is it rational to think that a person who was caught with thousands of bags of heroin will show up to court once released and face a 15 to 25 year prison sentence? In my 32 years of experience, I think that everyone in this room knows what the answer to that is. This defies logic and common sense and will result in more lives being lost due to this epidemic and more communities suffering. More work certainly needs to be done to address this new law. These measures will help, but more amendments are certainly needed beyond today. This is a nonpartisan issue for sheriffs across New York State. And I would hope for all New Yorkers who know that this new law will determine what this new law will really entail. For us, the sheriffs of New York State, all we care about is keeping our community safe. We see our offices as apolitical. We do not ask political affiliations when someone calls 911. We swear an oath to serve all people and apply equal and fair justice under the law. We want the public to know that effective January 1st, we will be significantly restricted in carrying out our mission. And that's not just for the sheriffs, that's for all law enforcement and all police across New York State. We will literally, this is a literal statement, no longer be handcuffing offenders who victimize our communities. The handcuffs are going on us. We strongly urge all New Yorkers to contact your state representatives, especially the ones that supported this legislation, including the governor, and demand that your voices be heard. Demand they stop putting felons before families and change to restore common sense to our criminal justice system before it's too late. Thank you very much.
You know, I'm a big believer that a lot of issues transcend politics, and this is one. This is not a partisan issue. In fact, in his budget this year, the governor's bail reform plan included taking dangerousness into account. These bills are about public safety. They're about protecting victims, and those are things I think we can all get behind. So I sincerely thank you for being here today, and I just want to say a special thank you to the media. You know, when I think about our constituents, they're so busy living their lives. A lot of times they don't even know when these laws are passed or come into play until it's too late. They trust their legislators, trust them to keep them safe. So that's what we're trying to do today, to do the right thing. So thank you. Yeah. Any questions from the media? That I would have to hand over to the expertise on. Well, your former law enforcement.
The district attorney may want to speak. Really simple. This permits a judge. It doesn't require a judge to do that, and it grants them the discretion that we've placed our trust in judges through various elections. And this bill just gives them the discretion to make that decision. It allows it. It doesn't require it. And so it would be up to them. It's not specifically defined.
It's under the discretion of the judge.
Yes.
And so is it my understanding that the first bill will not affect which charges are qualifying charges or crimes, but it will allow the judge to
Correct.
So you're saying this is not a partisan issue, but it kind of sounds like it would be a good issue against Democrats next year when Republicans want to challenge them for public the offices more. They hold. Yeah.
You know, and I know a lot of you don't know me personally, but I always say there are issues that you take the R and the D out of it. We're not doing this for this reason. And I've said all along, all year, we have a lot of new legislators. And you know, if you ever hear the term, you don't know what you don't know. Well, they didn't talk to people that actually do this for a living, that have skin in the game. I think once they hear this and they have conversations with their DAs and law enforcement, they're going to realize how dangerous this bill is and that we need to pass this new legislation. So thank you for your question.
Let me add to that. If we cared solely about politics, we would let the bad things happen and then try to use it in an election. We care about public safety and we care about serving the citizens, certainly of our district, those that have placed their trust in us to represent them, and across the state. So I think the not being a partisan issue that we're speaking of is public safety and our obligation to do something about public safety.
So it's my understanding that the bail crime already counts sex offenses, even misdemeanor ones, as qualifying crimes. Can you explain to me how the second bill would expand that, or what is the second bill that would be responsible for sexual crimes? Is it expanding the number of criminal statutes?
Well, the judge could detain them and have cash bail. I mean, that's the most important thing, that they can do that. When you think about it, like we were talking about domestic violence victims, you can't give somebody that's an abuser an appearance ticket and then not put that person in danger. You heard, you know, very eloquently from Leah and Bronca about the dangerousness of that. So that's what that bill addresses.
Is there an expanded number of sex crimes that are not covered?
Yes. So the second bill deals with domestic violence, and essentially it, for the purpose of setting bail, it expands the definition of which crimes are included as domestic violence offenses when occurring between members of the same household.
Okay, I was just getting confused in the second part, that it's domestic.
Yeah, so the second bill expands the scope of what fits under the domestic violence exception in the no cash bail law as it will exist November 1st. I'm sorry, January 1st.
Yesterday, Governor Cuomo made some remarks about this, and he said that this is working in New Jersey. Do you have any evidence that it's not working in New Jersey?
The answer is yes, and I wish I brought it. We could come up with some studies that have been done afterwards that certain crimes have gone up. More people than in the past have not returned to court. There's more absconders out there, and cost has increased significantly. So a whole host of things. People not responding to court like they should at the rates that they were before New Jersey changed the law, enhanced public safety risk with evidence, with data to back it up, and a much greater cost because there's more people out there with some of the pretrial supervision and things of that nature.
What do you think about the governor's response to this when questioning, what is your message to him?
I'll speak for myself. I think we need to make this amendment to enhance public safety, and I hope the governor cares about the citizens of the state.
Were there parts of the bail reform law that you supported?
Pardon me?
Were there parts of the bail reform law that you supported?
I think we should always be looking at all laws, but when it speaks to criminal justice in general, we should be looking at it to see if it works or if it doesn't work. I've always been, throughout my law enforcement career, I mean, as a criminal justice professional, I'm supportive of alternatives to incarceration, and we need to invest in it. We can't just, some would have it, the far right would have it, lock them up, throw away the key, the far left would have it, program, and give things out and don't lock anybody up. We need a balance. Mm-hmm. There is evidence that shows that programming works. Trying to help work to change a mindset does work in the rehabilitation process, and government has to, provide some resources for that. But the data also shows that there's some people that no matter what you've done are inclined to be repeat offenders, and we see that time and time again. So, Dan, there was no specific pieces of legislation regarding bail. It was just this. There was no other ideas put forward. We put some forward, focus more around this. You have to be concerned with public safety and repeat offenders, but it really fell upon deaf ears.
Just kind of on that topic, maybe from members of law enforcement, have you heard any concerns from pre-trial services agencies about the lack of funding to deal with the bail reform law?
I think that, yes, there's a huge concern that this will end up just being another unfunded mandate being put upon local governments in regard to pretrial services. For example, in my county where I come from, we don't even offer pretrial services. So we've kind of got the cart before the horse here.
And a related topic, this is for DA Hoefler. Governor Cuomo said yesterday DA shouldn't get more money to carry out the discovery changes, which, as you know, require that you turn over evidence much more quickly to defendants. What do you think of his remarks yesterday?
It's the governor of the state of New York, he can say what he wants. It's gonna cost the local taxpayers money. The people that are gonna pay for this are gonna be upstate. And again, you have to always understand in our state, we have New York City and then we sort of have the rest of the state. In my county, Orange County, property tax, the local citizens pay for the services that they get from law enforcement, from pretrial services, from the DA's office. It's in their property tax bill that they get every January. The only way those services can be increased or made better is by taxing them more. So it's nothing more than an unfunded mandate. And I don't understand why the cornerstone of all reform has to be rehabilitation and services. If you want to reform, you have to have services and you have to have services that can rehabilitate people. If you want to stop some, if you want to stop a serial shoplifter, then sometimes you can if you can rehabilitate them, find them a job, find out, you know, what is the issue that's causing that. But the way this system is being rolled out, that's not going to happen. When we rolled out Raise the Age, there was discussion, there was thoughtfulness put into it, there was a lot of money put behind it. This, it's not being done with what we have here, with bail reform, with discovery reform. And what's gonna happen is the local taxpayers are gonna foot the bill, and once you get upstate, you're gonna have individuals that are gonna be upset that money is going to criminal justice services when it's not going to their local park. And again, your local elected officials are going to have to make those decisions what they want to fund.
So do you think the DAs can carry out the changes to the discovery laws right now?
We're going to try. Every DA in the state's going to try. I think that what you'll see is there's going to be difficulties. I can only speak to my county. We have over almost 40 different law enforcement agencies. They all have different computer systems. There's no central link to the district attorney's office. We have courts that meet once a month. We have, you know, a good third of the judges in my county are not even lawyers. And now you're asking them to participate in a very complex process. I'm not saying that they're not bad, that they're bad people or they're not well-meaning, but again, this was rolled out with the idea that New York City has an infrastructure of services that are available to people almost immediately. You heard the sheriff speak. There's no pretrial services in his county. In my county, the pretrial services are very scant. It's the Department of Probation, that's it. And again, how do you connect somebody with services upstate when you have a night court that's meeting at 7:30 at night and a person needs drug treatment? What are you gonna do? Those are things that were never thought about in any way, shape, or form with this type of, with this reform. And again, to have meaningful reform in any way, shape, or form, you must have some type of services element and a services delivery point up front. And this legislation doesn't have that.
If I may add just one point, it's not directly to your question about the payment, but the district attorney, when he just talked about the drug offenders, I'm part of a joint opioid task force. We've been traveling the state to try to deal with that particular issue. It's a Senate task force, and we're hearing from many, many people, but we've heard from a number of judges, specifically the opioid court judges or the drug court judges, in some places that they're very successful in helping to turn people's lives around. They testified that they're very concerned about the new bail law because that person is who's getting an appearance ticket is not likely going to show up in their court when they need help. They're not going to show up for 3 weeks. So before, when they had bail set, they would be arraigned within that next morning or the within 72 hours. They'd agree to participate in the process of the particular drug court seeking treatment immediately, and they'd have a great deal of success with it. So that is also a concern that hasn't been mentioned today, but has been testified to by judges across the state.
Thank you very much once again for being here today.
Thank you.
Thank you for everyone here. Thank you.